experience against this lineup. That's definitely going to play into their favor. I'm going to be, for me, I don't want London Conspiracy to focus their game around assaults on A, because virtus.pro have shown themselves to be maybe, or having rather, one of the best defenses up there with Dignitas, the best CT sides, for A-side defenses. I think the hole to be picked in virtus.pro's game, if they go defensive, is definitely more towards taking over mid, taking over the balcony CPL area, and then trying to work the options from there. Because connector, virtus.pro now have the such a strong ability in coordination to lock it down. They have such strong coordination locking down A house, the palace, and also the T slope. They're very, very good at that. So for me, with London Conspiracy, I would be worried for them if they try to force their way too much on A. And a lot of teams do that because it is, generally speaking, the easier option on this map.
Mm-hmm. As we can see here, the London Conspiracy lineup consists of Skirk, Rubino, Rain, Mac, and Polly. Rain is the new player that we should be looking out for, and let's see if he'll be a good enough replacement for Polly. Anyway, we start off with a Nightcrown, and Nightcrowns are absolutely wonderful. You know why? Because you don't have to talk about them. You don't have to say anything about Nightcrowns.
You get sequel skins.
You can see a bit of knife action and whatnot. But as we mentioned before, and as we keep mentioning again, the winner of the knife round gets to decide which side they'll start off as. And on Mirage, it's general consensus that it's good to start off as a CT. Although it's one of those maps that's relatively balanced, just like Inferno. But you can say it's a CT-sided map. And to be honest, especially a team like London Conspiracy, when you're not the team that is the favorites, you kind of want to start off on the strong side and kind of start getting a lead and get a few games. I mean, I remember Wizards played against Team Global in the Spring League, and they were able to get a 7-0 lead just because they started off as CTs. They weren't able to win the game, but that's a great lead to have.
And it relieves a lot of pressure.
It does. It relieves a lot of pressure,
is really, really difficult from an economy perspective. So if you don't do badly on the pistol, it's actually a lot harder to get back into the game.
Yeah,
it takes a bit slower to get back into the game. So
and you lose the confidence. I mean, if you play second half with only 3-4 rounds, you don't have the confidence to go on, and especially if you play against a stronger side. But we've seen strong sides come back from those odds, and it's expected because they are strong sides. They're ready to do that. And as we saw just now, London Conspiracy won the knife round, so they'll be starting off as a CT side. They're not going to make any dodgy choices. I mean, we've seen some teams in the past choose the weaker side for reasons of their own. I'm not going to debate what reasons they are, but you can unsettle your opponents if you play on a weaker side and do really well. And then some teams believe that the weaker side is actually the stronger side. For example, Titan on DDoS2, who believe CT is much stronger. As we can see here, we do have two players going towards apartments, going towards bombsite B, while the rest of the team is waiting for an execute into A. Now, I think they're trying to put the terrorists a bit off. Actually, no, they're going through the underground towards mid, and that's an interesting choice here. I do believe the CTs might have caught wind of him. Skirk throwing that smoke, making them, obscuring their vision, and he's actually able to get a kill there on Pasha. As the execute starts for the T side. Nice double nade there by Bialy and Neo to take down Rain. Snacks keeping them from pushing in from window. He's doing a good job at that as well. Bomb is planted. And now it's up for the CTs for the retake. Mac getting a nice headshot there on Neo. It's some very fast-paced actions. We have terrorists absolutely everywhere. London Conspiracy not doing a bad job. They are getting into the bomb site, but Taz and Bialy are the men standing, and there's not a lot of HP left on Rubino and Mac. Mac goes down. Rubino's the last man standing. It's him against Bialy and Taz. And all he needed was a shot on Bialy there, but Bialy got the better of him. 1-0 for the Poles, and London Conspiracy not doing so terribly bad.
So we saw this is the meta game, and you put like three players on B. This is how it works. You have a player kind of, and you play a defensive player here because you play for the retake on A, and that's the way that London Conspiracy played. They played for that retake. It was pretty even as we saw, and you know, not really much to say other than that. It was a pretty standard round. virtus.pro didn't try anything sneaky because you can try to metagame it by doing a fake on A after a delay with some decoys and stuff, but they didn't go for anything like that. It's just very, very standard. And this goes to something you were saying previously. As we go through this eco round, we do see the pistols and armor coming out from London Conspiracy. Yep. And this is actually a big risk on the CT side because this can really have a big detriment to your economy. Unless you do a lot of damage or even win the round, this can be very, very risky. And And we'll see if they're able to pull something off. But VODS Pro, nothing surprising. They're relying on fundamentals to win against London Conspiracy. Nothing special. That's what they want to do right now.
It was an interesting push into bomb site A, though, going in from the underground. We haven't seen that a lot. We got two men coming in from the tunnels rather than coming in straight from mid. But they do have control of mid. They've smoked the window, and now they pretty much have full choice as to which bomb site they want to go to. They have quick access to both bomb site A and B. And it looks like they'll be going towards bomb site A. Pasha pushing it, able to jump over Rain and get that kill into the bomb site. They do have control of it. Now it's up to the CTs to try and retake it. Rubio getting a kill at window, and that's not bad whatsoever. Snacks put down to 13 HP. Will Rubino be able to finish him off? Oh, he gets himself a double. Very nice there by Rubino. And now it's back to a 2-on-3 situation. Neo, though, making it a 2-on-2 as he gets that kill on Polly. Rubino picking up that Galil. Is he able to do any damage with that? Are they going to try and defuse the bomb and try and keep off the terrace at the same time? Skirt getting that kill on Bialy with only 7 HP left. Is he just going to try and go for the defuse? Neo, is he... Goodness me, is he... Oh my goodness, oh my goodness. What just happened there? He went for the warbang, and then he left him and stopped the other guy from defusing the bomb, and then went and saw him and shot him. How does that work? What just happened right there?
Yeah, it's a really confusing situation.
I just got really confused.
I think that's one of those situations where Patch's like, wait, does this warbang actually work? Because right there, there's very little options for the defuser. He can hold it, or that's it. Like, because he's not got the time. He's got all the health either. He has to 1B his opponent, so he's going for the hold. Didn't work.
And he at the same time, nice there by Rain.
Wow.
Drops the bomb, double kill with a CZ. Well, Polly's the last man standing though. But one thing I was just about to mention is that he stayed in the same position and he didn't go for the defuse. If he had continued, it would have been a defuse 100%. So yeah. I really don't know what happened at that moment.
It takes balls to hold a defuse without a kit. So yeah. I can understand it, because in some sense...
But you're getting shot anyway.
Neo should be in a position there always to punish even a 5 second, you know, even with a kit. Yeah. And so it's kind of weird for Neo, like his position there. And it was a bit of a snafu, but and you can see him, he flustered a little bit. He's like, oh crap, I didn't actually think this through. Yeah. And we had that weird situation. But luckily for VODS Pro, it didn't blow up in their faces, so it's okay. But despite the investments we saw from London Conspiracy here, they did a lot of damage with the pistols. And you can see why they actually went for these players, because even though they didn't win, they did a lot of economic damage, and they did a really good job. I mean, loads of players from VODS Pro were going down there, so they're keeping VODS Pro's money in check. They come into the buy now, and if they're able to win here, then they're in an okay economic situation, and VODS Pro didn't build bank, and that's a dangerous thing for the terrorists if they start building the bank.
Yeah, if they start losing runs now, they're going to be put back to pretty much step one. Polly was able to save that AK-47. Now he has a defuse kit. That's fading relatively well. Again, we do have two men at B, two at tunnels. They do know the terrorists are pretty much going for mid. They've gone for mid every single round so far. So they do have to have men there to try and contest it at least. Because mid is really the key to this map. Holding mid gives you access to every bomb site, gives you access to map control, and gives you access to a lot of information.
Is absolutely crucial, and it seems as if the VODS Pro are going to be able to make their way through mid, through B. They've chosen their site to take down, and London Conspiracy are going to have to scramble to deal with this. And there is Snacks. He's in between every single player. He's going to deal with two. There's one more on CD spawn. He's going to go for that kill shot. He gets it on Rain.
Wow.
What a play.
Snacks. Goodness me. Very nice triple kill from Snacks, and it's something that we've mentioned. Every single one of these players is up for that. For VODS Pro, they can... every single player can win a situation like that, a 3-on-1 situation like that. That's what makes them so very dangerous. London Conspiracy are actually doing worse on the buy round than they did on any of the others.
Yeah.
Which is really interesting. Perhaps they were unlucky. Perhaps they should have thought it out a bit better. We do have three men pretty much in the same position here over at the stairs.
Eagle sniper coming out from Rain. Is he going to get one? Not quite. Looking for that shot. There it is.
Got a headshot. Not bad by Rain. He did his job. And he got himself a kill at least. It's a nice trade. But these smokes are going to put both the CTs out of the combat, really. Either have to rotate or be patient. Bino will be coming in from CT spot. See if he can pick off one or two people. We have one terrorist in the smoke, and it wasn't very advantageous for him to come out. And Pasha with a double kill, easily taking down the opponents. That's another easy anti-eco by VODS Pro. They lost two men, Bialy and Neo, but that's not a lot of damage.
Oh, the Scar already coming out for Ruben? Oh, that is interesting. Really nice. There's lots of options for the Scar. You can play a Scar anywhere on this map. This, I imagine the apartments is the most common one for this because you smoke it. If you hear it stepping from your when your teammates hear stepping in apartments, you just start spamming away. It's pretty golden. Yeah. So we'll see how he decides to play this.
Well, they've been very, very fast into their push through apartments. They put the bomb down and saw if they could get any of the CTs out of their position, and that's what they did. But Rubino's able to survive that relatively well.
Have you seen this
nice.
Before?
No,
I haven't seen this before.
This is a very nice little what's
boost.
The word? Boost, goodness me.
Really good boost.
I can't. Got English.
I'm always seeing new boosts. I've seen another one on the like in above
up
the
there,
pillar.
Yeah, yeah. On the pillar.
You can't.
Yeah.
It's like an invisible ledge.
You can't see it. Yeah.
How
yeah.
did someone figure that
you
one
just
out?
Have to, you just have to try it out. You have to keep trying. Rubino trying to see if he can get one of the T's off. The bomb is actually there. I don't know if the CTs are aware of that. Bialy picks it up. Actually, Polly getting a kill on Snacks at mid. Now, I don't think this Scar is going to be used too much available because they do know it's at bombsite B and they're probably banking and putting their money on bombsite A. They really don't want to go against that Scar in that kind of position. It's not very advantageous for the T side, but they have relative good map control. They've got mid, they've got one guy here in connector, but he will be taken down by Mac, and that's good movement there by the CTs. It's 5-on-3, 5-on-2, 5-on-1. Bialy's the last man standing, and this is an almost flawless round by London Conspiracy, who did a great job holding their positions, and they pretty much took virtus.pro man-to-man.
If I was virtus.pro in this round, what I would do is or as far as London Conspiracy right now, I would assume that virtus.pro is going to try to hit A right now, try to play away from the Scar and do it like somewhat quickly. Of course, virtus.pro looks like they want to actually battle the Scar. They've got the AWPs, they've got the AKs moving towards the B house. So it looks like they want to go against that position head on. You can do it with smokes. You can get some precision smokes on the car and to block off that Scar. So that could work well for them as well. But virtus.pro getting a bit too slow in that last round, and great discipline from London Conspiracy to hold their positions despite all the traffic on B. They didn't lose a man, just got damaged a bit, and with the nades they've pushed them back. virtus.pro, plan B didn't really work, did it?
No, pushing into bombsite A though, they lost too many men before the execute. One at connector who was there for too long, basically. The smoke disappeared and Mac was able to get the kill on him. However, right now we do have one man all the way at bombsite B in apartments. That is Pasha, seeing if perhaps he can get a pick on Skirk, on Rubino, sorry, with that AWP. I think in the AWP and auto sniper matchup, the AWP gets the better of the auto sniper, but he is backing away. And they do have 35 seconds left on the clock. It is a bombsite A execute. Skirk gets wind of that, and he's coming back to support his teammates. There are four men pretty much in bombsite A. Will they be able to defend it against these raging Polish warriors who are rushing into the bombsite? Nades come down. That's quite a lot of damage. Very aggressive here by Snacks as he gets the kill on Rain. Polly returning the favor with a kill on Pasha. Skirk taking down Neo. But Snacks doing very, very well so far. Has a double kill this round. Picks up the AWP. What a wonderful quickscope there. It's 2-on-2, and Snacks is really, really keeping virtus.pro into this game. A quick bomb plant by him, because there's only 1 second left on the clock, and he just makes it, and the CTs should have contested that a bit more. There was only 3 seconds left. Now they have to retake the bomb site. Now time is against them. Snacks will get the kill on Rubino, and probably will miss that shot on Taz. And from a round that looked like it was the London Conspiracy round, it was the round for the Norwegians, it all of a sudden went horribly bad after Snacks got that amazing triple kill and was able to plant the bomb in the last second as well.
And we can see a bit of a kind of a force buy coming out here. You know, Mag on Rubino. I mean, I guess it's not really a force buy. It's just Rubino who was kind of economically crippled. So it's not that bad if you put Rubino in a good spot. Let's see where he's playing, actually. We can see him. He's actually going to play apartments, which is an interesting choice, although Pasha going to pop off the head of Mag over towards A. Polly's going to get a return, so that's pretty good, slowing down the aggression. And look at this, the double back coming in from virtus.pro all the way around here. Are they going to catch London Conspiracy out of position? If they're really quick with this, London Conspiracy might not rotate in time, and that's perhaps what virtus.pro will be banking on. Or are they just going to go for a slow mid-take? They have a lot of time. The options are available for them, and it's up to their caller to decide how to handle this situation. But clearly A is not the end goal right now.
Yep, I don't think they're trying to do something fast or something sneaky, but they're really going for the bread and butter, controlling mid and trying to go through from B tunnels. They do know there's only one person on the bomb site at the moment. They caught sight of one of the CTs at mid, and they're just putting their money on that. Rubino doesn't have the auto sniper. They know he probably, well, most likely couldn't afford another one. And that made it a bit more of a nicer bomb site to attack. Much as they're coming in on both Skirk and Rubino. Molotov into the bomb site. Rubino, if he hops up now, won't be able to do enough damage. Bialy will take him down, and Bialy will take down Skirk as well. Bomb is planted. It's 3-on-2 as Polly and Rain have to retake the bomb site from the terrorist. And bomb site B is a bomb site you really don't want to retake. It's very tough to retake. It's all up to Rain right now. He's smoked off. He's only got an M4. He's just going to pick up the AWP and try and go for a save. We'll be able to get a kill on Pasha. That drops the AWP for the T side. But Bialy, with a triple kill that round, will finish off the job for the Poles. 7-1, but we've had some pretty close rounds so far.
It has been really, really close. It's quite unfortunate for London Conspiracy. I mean, the economy is really in a bad place. Already at a point where VODS Pro, if they don't win any more rounds right now, they're completely comfortable with the work that they've done because their CT side is so strong. And that's really the thing you've got to worry about. And here goes an aggressive push on mid here from Polly at the very least. That's just with the USP, not going to accomplish anything apart from gaining some info for his teammates, who now know where to concentrate their efforts with their pistols. But that's all they have, the pistols. They're not going to get much done with that in this round unless someone comes out with a big play. So VODS Pro so far seem to be stomping over London Conspiracy. Do you feel like it's just overall execution, better fundamentals, or do you feel like there is a hole in London Conspiracy?
I think a lot of it has to do... London Conspiracy are not doing a bad job so far. I think a lot of it... They've made one or two mistakes, especially during that bomb defuse, bomb plant by Snacks. They shouldn't have let him plant the bomb, but they've been playing relatively well Counter-Strike. The main issue is that you are getting these crazy clutches and these crazy three-man kills and two-man kills by players like Snacks and Bialy. And no matter how much you plan for them, if that happens in the middle of the round, it puts everything to waste. It really makes it a really, really tough round to play after, you know, from 4-2 up to 4-3 up, you go down to 4-0. But it's going relatively well for London Conspiracy as far as beginning of the rounds, but mid and end rounds, mid-late rounds, VODS Pro are getting the better of them. It's 8-1 right now, and they have to definitely change something sooner or later.
So let's see how this goes. All right, now this is a very critical buy round here for London Conspiracy. Max going to open it up with a frag onto Taz. So that is a good start for them to deny the A split that appears to be happening as we speak here. Neo makes his way in. A good Molotov going in there over by the stairs. Although this will slow down VODS Pro slightly. But they do even the playing field. There is the good response from Polly as VODS Pro now are looking at a one-man deficit with Pasha barely walking with three health, but Bialy coming in with a frag, Snacks chiming in as well. Now it's just Rubino and Polly left to defend the A bomb site. VODS Pro, they want this A bomb site so badly, and what was that? The last bullet, the quick switch. There goes a grenade to finish off Polly, and it's now a one-on-one. Snacks.
One-on-two.
Oh, one-on-two, my bad. Pasha's like limping right now. He needs a blood transfusion or something. Snacks just chilling over there by the bomb. And this is going to be really hard for Rubino. He's got full health, though.
Well, Rubino is very capable of doing it. He's in 2-1 situation, but they don't have a lot of health. He gets the first kill. Will he get the second? Be able to defuse the bomb? He knows he's right behind the barrel somewhere. He's coming from behind. He's not going to check.
Oh!
Very nice there by Rubino. And he will most likely get the bomb defused. Or will he? 5 seconds.
He's got this.
Left on the timer.
That was such a needed round there.
Well,
for London Conspiracy. I mean, their economy is in a very, very, very bad place at the moment. The future looks still morbid as they cannot afford to lose a single round. Again, if they do, they're forced to eco. Then it's, you know, guaranteed 10 rounds for VODS Pro. They're already in very uncomfortable territory. If they want to have a good run at this game, they're going to need to put more on the board than just two. So let's see how they're able to accomplish that. You know, we saw some very expensive decisions from them before with the scars very early on, and that really, really hindered them economically speaking later on. So let's see if they can do more with less in this round.
And they're forced to buy two FAMASs. No head armor for Rain. Doesn't really need it against AK-47s. Not at the distances that they are playing at the moment. London Conspiracy have to win some rounds. And they have to get their act together. Polly doing quite a bit of damage on Pasha, but not enough as he gets shot down by Snacks. Bialy pushing in from bombsite B. He'll be taken down by Rubino. Mac through the flash. will take out Snacks, and that's overconfidence there by the T site. Which bomb site are they going to go towards? Looks like they might be pushing towards bomb site, but they are. They're pretty much covered from every single angle. They don't have much to go. Moving back, they're probably going to get shot. Moving into the bomb site, they're probably going to get shot. And Mac and Skirk will finish off the job. 8-3, London Conspiracy winning a third round for them.
Okay, so this is a really funny situation. So they VODS threw a Molotov here, which is really funny. Because what you're saying is, if there is a player there, all right, I'm going to toast him. Yeah. So he's probably going to move. And so that's what happened. He was like running across. And they kind of didn't anticipate that, which is kind of the point of the Molotov, yeah. To remove people from the position. And so like they ended up getting killed by the surprise. That was
But I think also
funny.
there's a flash, and they expected him not to shoot. He was flashing. He just fired all over the place, and he was able to take down Snacks, who was pushing through. So yeah, sometimes if you're flashed, keep your finger on the mouse click. It'll work out for you.
Got an A split coming up here on Slope and House going in right now. London Conspiracy. They should have worked out what's going on through the absence of any Polish members over at the B house, and Snacks is just executing them one by one.
Wow.
And now it's just a three-man retake possibility for London Conspiracy. It is not going well. Snacks at least is quite low, but I don't know if they're able to be able to pull this one off. Skirk is doing his best from connector, but how much can he really get done? It's a 2-1-4 at this point. Rubino and Skirk with a lot of work to do.
Taz will get the kill on Rubino, who's hiding in the smoke, and these are really nice smokes there by VODS.pro. They pretty much took control of the bomb site through these smokes, and Snacks is very sneaky ninja work, is able to jump down without any of the CTs knowing. But there you go, VODS.pro winning the ninth round for them, and so putting London Conspiracy in a pretty tough situation. Are they going to go for an eco or a force buy? Well, we do see some armor. There's actually a force buy here by London Conspiracy. The Norwegians trying as hard as they can to get that fourth round. They won't be giving away anything. But an interesting push there by VODS.pro, an interesting defense as well by the CT side. Aggressive, as Mac will get a kill and get away with it as well, but Taz will punish him. He should have backed away all the way towards the bomb site. The smoke was there to conceal him. However, in these kind of situations, trade is not so bad. They're getting one man for every man. But Pasha making it two. As Rain will take down Taz. Not a bad eco round for them. Rubino in a 2-on-1 situation. Most likely unable to survive the crossfire. But good economic damage on VODS.pro. They've got two rounds left. Two rounds they can win. They can put it to a 10-5 and make it perhaps, more achievable. Make the winner more achievable. As you can see, Snacks with 17 kills and 6 deaths. He's been absolutely dominating. Pashi as well doing a great job with 15. Bialy with 11. And Neo at the bottom with 4.
Snacks, Bialy combo too strong.
They're doing really well. Snacks and Bialy have they're new to the scene. They're relatively new players compared to the three members of the Golden Five who they're playing with at the moment. And they've proven they really do have the talent. And it's a slow push into apartments right now. We do have Polly in the underground. He pushes up the stairs in the opportune moment. Could be very, very damaging for the Poles. And right now, he's just making sure they don't go for that rotation. Okay, headshot on Skirk. As they push, they have no idea there's a CT behind them. Is he going to go for the shots, or is he going to try and get closer, make sure he gets more kills? I think he's a bit too late. Well, they realize that somebody's coming up from behind. They don't hear him. Now he has to play it very, very, very carefully. Polly will get the first. Will he get the second? Very nice work there by Polly. He gets two kills. Now it's a 2-on-2 situation. Taz and Pasha versus Mac and Polly. Polly's in the bomb site. One of them has to defend while the other defuses. We have one T all the way.
Nice.
All the way in middle. And he's just going to have to go for the save as they've lost the bomb site. And the defuse goes through. And that was a weird, weird little situation for VODS.pro to be in.
Okay, now this is there's always these discussions about M31S versus M34. This is obviously a situation where the silencer is golden because he gets the first frag. They have no idea where he is because they're expecting certain places for him to be. They weren't expecting the flank. They just weren't expecting that. So he has the element of surprise not once but twice and then a third time. So that's what it's good for. And if you're flanking a player, and Pasha, look at that. He's just a monster. with that AWP. He's so stable, so consistent, and he is going to cripple London Conspiracy. They have very limited options at this point, and virtus.pro know it, so they're just going to try to kill the time and just play together. Something that virtus.pro are great at doing, supporting one another, getting the trades. If they play the trade game well at this point, and here it goes, there is the trade, then they should win this with the man advantage. Rubino is the last man standing, and he's got a hell of a lot of work to do.
And sadly, he was only able to take one down before he went 11-4. They weren't able to get the fifth round, but four rounds on the CT side, it doesn't bode too well.
So London Conspiracy aren't having a good time here against virtus.pro. Expected though, let's see what they're able to pull together on the aggressive side. And this is the side, of course, the Terra side is where you get to decide the pace of the game most of the time. That's how it works. So virtus.pro have to play around them. They have to adapt to what London Conspiracy decide to do. And London Conspiracy have to try to find the holes in, or at least the holes that they feel like virtus.pro have, the weaknesses that virtus.pro have, they have to try to attack those. What those are, if you ask me, I don't know if there are many. But, I have a theory at least about how to defeat, you know, ways to defeat virtus.pro, but it's not easy. It's not simple.
No.
It's not simple. This
I mean, something like what Poly did there, was something they would not expect. Mm. And that's definitely something that's going to win you rounds. These kind of plays are very sneaky. But it's all about having the information, knowing exactly where the enemy is so that you can do things like that. If you don't have the information, if you don't have the positioning, if you don't have map control, you can't do that. And now, as we see here, we do have most likely a bombsite B push here by the Norwegian side there, keeping it nice and quiet. And there's a smoke, which I do believe was thrown by Snacks. Try and help him with control. And we have Pasha coming up from behind. This is the aggressive kind of CT play that we see from virtus.pro on this map, where they get the information. No, they're in the bomb site. They give away the bomb site, actually. So the bomb is going to be planted. And now virtus.pro have to retake it. Pasha. A lot of damage has been dealt towards the range on 15 HP. Pasha's going to come up from behind. And it's not going to work out for him, but Neo and Taz both getting a kill each into the bomb site. It's 2-on-2 right now. Neo and Bjali. Yes, two of the terrorists, but they don't have a lot of HP left. Mac will be shot down by Bjali, and Neo will get that really nice headshot on Skirt. Goodness me. I didn't even know he could get a headshot from that angle while moving as well. Bomb gets defused. And it should have been a round for London Conspiracy.
Yeah, that looked really, really good for them because, as well, they got the bomb down. They got their post plant set up. They had some nades to help them too. And virtus.pro, their retake was very scattered or desync. So it was a lot of waiting around for virtus.pro to try to get some coordination going. So it was by no means a simple job to get that retake going, but somehow they forced it in. It's like having the triangle and putting it in the circle. Like, that's what they did. They just forced it in a place it didn't belong. They managed to make it work, and in this anti-eco, it seems all but too easy of a cleanup for them.
Yeah, as you can see, the CT's known that they're on an eco. They're going very, very plain, very aggressively, keeping the map control to them, not giving them any quarter. But Rain with a double kill with that deagle.
Oh, that was
sadly. Yeah,
so I wanted it so much.
If he had made that shot, that would have been absolutely amazing. He would have put himself on a one-on-one situation. Mm. But sadly, he does pretty good damage towards them. Not a bad eco by them. Now they were able to go for a full buy because they had planted the bomb in the first round. So they can go for an early full buy. And let's see if they're able to do something in this kind of situation. I mean, this is the round that really decides whether London Conspiracy have any chance of coming back against the Poles. The Poles are so good, both on T and CT. But will London Conspiracy have that little edge as the terrorist side? They were able to go into bombsite B in the first round on the pistol round, but will they be able to do anything with AK-47s with that long-range play? We do have Skirk here in apartments.
I like what they're doing right now because London Conspiracy are playing this defensively. You can see how defensive their line is across the map. They're kind of allowing Virtus, because they're predicting maybe an aggressive play. virtus.pro have a lot of rounds. virtus.pro like to play risky and aggressive. That is their nature. So London Conspiracy are playing against that because virtus.pro, they have so many rounds to work with. They can take as many risks as they like, really, and still have a strong chance. So London Conspiracy are trying to get picks, trying to capitalize on any aggressive plays by playing defensive. Now it's time to go, though. And here they go into the site, flooding their way into that bomb site. Skirt going to come out, tap down Bialy, drops on to the head of Taz. It is going not so well for them, though. Oh, another kill.
Oy,
oh, no.
Unlucky by Skirk. Unlucky. Wow, with 1 HP, he did quite a lot of damage. Almost got three men. And Rubino, unable to finish off the job. Actually, Skirk there pushed at the opportune moment. And I think one of the smokes was a bit late as well, going into the bombsite. And that caused them to lose one of their players, as Taz wasn't smoked off up on the stairs near connector. But that, it wasn't a perfect execute, but a relatively good one at that. And it kind of showed that they could, they can contest virtus.pro. They can, make him feel a bit of pain, but virtus.pro are just looking far, far too solid. And 14-4, only two more rounds for the Poles to win this game. It's not looking so great for London Conspiracy. It looks like they're going to have to be playing in the loser's bracket after this. And virtus.pro most likely going to continue to the winner's bracket and will probably qualify and leave the group.
Definitely. So we're seeing actually, to even up the money, a couple grenades bought from Rubino. So how he intends to use those is going to be interesting, because that's going to tell us everything. Because it's two grenades, they're going to use that to an effect, and that's going to tell us what they plan to do. And Rubino's there. We can see him in mid. So perhaps trying to get a boost up, trying to put a smoke down in balcony. Doesn't even use the grenades, and they're falling to pieces right now. To make a comment about the last round, as Skirk actually picks up this M4A1, so maybe I'll hold off on that, see if he's able to pull off anything here. Because there are a few players weak for virtus.pro, and he might just get the drop on one of the poles here, and he does have to size M4. There he goes, with airdrop, doesn't make it. But a quick note, I feel like they did the right play on the previous round, but they played it slow, very defensive line. But I feel like they reacted too quickly, and just, let's just... shove all in on A. That it felt a bit too rushed. I think if they had taken that a bit more slowly, maybe tried to work more in the house and just use more time, I feel like they may have had a better chance there. But I'm not sure what forced them to rush so much.
virtus.pro are just such a good team. They've got so much individual talent. It's really tough to go in any bombsite. I mean, it's really tough to find any weakness. But here, the last resort for the Norwegian side as they go for a bombsite A execute, pushing right through, trying to go through the Polish defense as hard as they can. Bialy flashed, but able to get the kill. Actually, Taz will get the kill. He was not subsequently flashed, and it looks pretty bad. Goodness me, Rubino with a double. Bialy getting that kill on Rain. And it's a 2-on-3 situation, as I do believe the hopes of London Conspiracy going through the group at this stage seem to be dwindling, as there are only two terrorists left. Now one. It's all up to Pauly here, who is going to stubbornly try and go through bombsite A. He will get a kill on Bialy. It's 1-on-2. Is he going to bring a miracle out of his pocket? Sadly not. 16-4 for virtus.pro. And that's what we kind of expected. The Poles are really dominating the Norwegian side, who did not do a bad job. It wasn't due to the fact that, well, they weren't playing good CS. It was just simply virtus.pro being so much better.
They were, frankly, quite amazing, as we expected. We did actually see a lot of plays towards B, and I feel like London Conspiracy probably have seen a lot of virtus.pro games, and their defenses on A have been very, very good. Some of the best I've seen. They're up there with Dignitas, who perhaps have one of the best CT sides in the game at the moment as well. So a lot of respect going into that and their A play. And they did try it out. I feel like they weren't so comfortable, and I feel like definitely they had some good ideas going in there, how to play against virtus.pro. They understood some of the, what was going on. Let's say, play defensively when virtus.pro want to throw risks at you.
Yep.
And virtus.pro weren't biting, though. They were just playing a very tight defensive style, because they probably found this is working. If we just play like this, it's working. We're going to out-execute them. We have better fundamentals. We're better players. We will just win like that. No special tricks required. Yep. No added thought required.
Yep. And we'll take a look at the groups. It looks like it's 12-9 for SK against Fnatic. An interesting score there. Fnatic probably the favorites. The SK lineup has not been playing so much together lately. They're a relatively new lineup. However, the match we just saw now, 16-4 for virtus.pro. It means that London Conspiracy will be playing in the loser bracket. They'll be playing against the loser of the other game, Fnatic versus SK. I wonder who it's going to be. Honestly, it's early days for that match at the moment. Four more rounds for SK. Mm. Fnatic can come back. They're not behind. It's really important for Fnatic. I think they're one of those teams that have been kind of struggling lately with their form. They've been one of those teams that are not playing the level they really are expected to play, especially since they won DreamHack Winter.
Yeah.
Especially since they won that 100,000 prize pool, and a lot of people are kind of saying, well, it seemed like that was a bit of luck.
I think really they came into their game at the right time, because if we remember, Pronax joined them and that leadership, it just hit the right moment in that team's life cycle, and everything clicked. Everything clicked, worked perfectly. I think as time has gone on, things have started to desync a little bit, and they are going through that right now. That they're going through a time of reforming their game, and they're still there. They're still in that process. This is a quite common thing as well for a lot of top teams when you're trying to find answers for your play. You're playing practice games. You're testing this. You're testing that. It's like, okay, this works. That works. Then eventually you get to a point like, okay, if we combine all these things, we try, and then you know, let's cement that as the style. This is what will work. And you know, that entire process takes a lot of time. And this is one of the reasons why Fnatic will be a great team, because not only are they very hardworking, not only do they have the talent and a great organization and someone like Khan behind them, a lot of experience, they have the chemistry. They're not going to split up. Yeah. You can't split up with bad results. If you have good chemistry, don't do
it. Definitely. And I think they're just they're a work in progress, I guess.
Yes, I think
but
so.
But depending on how long this work in progress is, depends on the survival of this team. And they definitely have to get some victories. They have to do something in some of the tournaments they play in, or else they're going to be in a lot of trouble. And I think if they don't do well in this tournament, we will probably see a change with Fnatic. I think this is really...
You think so?
Yeah, I think this is one of the last straws, because it's been quite a while. It's been quite a while.
I don't know. Those guys really love each other. Bro love there.
But they do have an organization, and the organization wants their team to do well. So they did a great job getting DreamHack Winter. I know it wasn't long ago, but still, it's been quite a while where they haven't achieved much. And they're a great team. You know, you've got JW.
Titan are in the same boat at the
Titan
moment.
At the moment, they are relatively in the same boat. Yeah. They were able to win one tournament, but the Hitbox tournament, and they did okay in the Spring League. But you know, they're not doing what they should be doing, which is winning. And you know,
top twos, all the
being
time.
Top two all the time, being in the finals all the time. So this again is a tournament that. It'll be a test for them. They're definitely going to be expected to go far in this tournament, especially with the new lineup.
It's one of those things, isn't it? It's just everything's relative. It's like when NIP, I was like, oh no, NIP, they lost the tournament. Or was it NIP that came fourth or something? What? I mean, because you're used to saying, oh, NIP are always top two. Yeah. That's what you're used to saying. And it's easy to forget. But they are actually really good. When they have a loss, it's not
exactly.
The end of the world.
It's not at the end of all. And this is the great thing about the CS scene at the moment, is that it's so volatile. It's so fluctuating. You've got a lot of big teams. The top five teams, all of them, the top 10 teams, all of them can beat each other. And that's really important. That's really interesting. It's very important because it means that the players are and the teams are kind of reaching similar levels. And, the Titan at one point were very good. They were far ahead. NIP at one point were far ahead. But now the gap is slowly being brought together, especially with virtus.pro. They weren't a team that people kind of expected earlier on in CS to CSGO to really be much of a team or be as good as they are now. But coming from Katowice, winning Katowice, it's given them a lot of confidence. And they're one of those teams that simply with pure practice were able to reach the same level and even a high level. And I mean, they've got the talent, they've got the experience, but with the practice on CSGO, they're able to reach the same level as NIP and Titan and all the other sides. And Dignitas and LDLC in the past few months have shown they're a top team.
Definitely. I can't wait to see Hellraisers actually, because good old Markov, we have no threats or something. I don't know, like just doing some
the Russian accent.
My Russian accent.
Ukrainian
even
accent, yeah.
I mean but that's funny to me. And they are like such an amazing lineup. But it does, we are having this thing with like you were saying, that you have this really cool team with Neo Taz and Pasha from the old days, and then the new Snacks and Bialy kind of combo coming in, the new blood. And you don't know if that's going to work, but when they on paper, you don't know if that will work.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Like when you put five great players together, don't know if it will work. And with Hellraisers, that was a question with the Sonic Dragons. When they were in the Sonic Dragons, everyone was like, okay, we're still waiting for you to do as good as we know you can. We're still waiting. They change organizations, things start to happen for them, but still, they still have so much talent, and we're not seeing the results there. Na'Vi, I think, are another really interesting one for me, because we don't see enough of them, and they are obviously monsters.
But I find it amazing. You know what I find amazing? I find amazing that there is a home ground kind of advantage in Counter-Strike.
Yes,
How does that work?
Actually,
I don't understand. The Polish win in Poland, all right? Ukrainians win in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. It's a pattern. The Swedes win in Sweden. Like, French win in France. Like, what is it? That means that, there's a lot more to Counter-Strike than we think in terms of the how much confidence has a role in it, and that playing at home, playing in a tournament that's hosted in your own country or your own city is a huge advantage.
Yeah, I think, I mean, as some of the other events, it's definitely harder to see. But at the Katowice, I think it was, for me, it looked like really clear. Because imagine being in the position of any team playing virtus.pro. virtus.pro, like, make a frag, and you hear the entire stadium roaring and vibrating with all the roars of the crowd. That must be incredibly intimidating to play against. And conversely, if you're virtus.pro, you're constantly like getting this energy from the crowd. And it is a huge, like, it makes you feel like the best. Like, yeah, course, the crowd is cheering.
I mean,
for you,
I was there.
Amazing.
I felt like I was Polish for a moment there. You know, I was in the crowd. Everybody was just going crazy. It was really good. And it's amazing to see that because it really makes the whole eSport look more viable as a sport.
Oh, yeah.
And it's all about the spectators. And the most important thing is you guys who are watching these tournaments. If you don't watch them, if you don't watch the game, it's not going to exist. So I'm sure, we have a lot to thank. To thank for, and the players have a lot to thank for. So keep spectating,
and keep spectating us because we're the handsomest stream.
Yes.
So I mean,
I'm sure you all agree.
Definitely. So we have more games coming up. One more coming up on the stream today.
Yes.
So that's going to be coming up very shortly. We have Fnatic, of course, versus London Conspiracy. So this should be a pretty decent match. You know, Fnatic, they should find their feet a little bit in this game at the very least, because London Conspiracy are not going to provide as much resistance as a team like virtus.pro. For Fnatic?
I want Fnatic to win.
You want to win?
Because, you know, they have the potential. But London Conspiracy is such a good sign as well. Honestly, this is going to be a close game. I believe
you
this will
so?
Be a close game. It's not going to be a Fnatic
score
being
prediction without
no.
seeing the map. Go.
Without seeing the map, you can't really do it. You can't. But I mean, if they play Inferno or if they play Mirage.
Yeah, we can. Let's say, give me an Inferno score prediction and a Mirage score prediction, because it's likely going to be those two. Or Dusty.
Inferno, I think Fnatic will win 16-12. And I think if they play Mirage, I can't really say. I don't know. I have this feeling LC can definitely kind of pull something out of this. But SK Gaming versus virtus.pro, that's going to be an interesting
That'll
game.
That'll be sick.
I have a feeling that virtus.pro are going to win. And virtus.pro, when they go through the group stages, then we get a rematch between SK Gaming and Fnatic. If Fnatic win, which would be very interesting. Again, we'll have the same thing as we had in... Actually, no. We didn't get that. We didn't get a rematch in Group A. Sorry. We might get a rematch in Group B between... SK and Fnatic in the final game.
Group B is a really nasty group. I mean, if we look at Group A, you know, it's pretty okay. Ents were replaced by Public Clear, but at the same time, you wouldn't expect Ents at their current form to really take down NIP, and you wouldn't expect them to take down Epsilon, who are playing like out of their minds right now. Because Berserk, we're putting up a great performance.
But I don't think people expected Berserk to play as well as they did. I think they did a great job. Interestingly enough, Epsilon beat them with a better score than against NIP. Yeah. I mean, it was one round difference, but it means Epsilon is, you know, they're on a relatively good level.
I saw a tweet from Get Right, and he's like, "Well, that Inferno game was weird." Like talking about the one against Berserk, but he's like, "Well, but we won, so great."
Yeah. So because there's some crazy plays there by Felix. Honestly, yeah. Crystal and Felix were absolutely mad. Yep. In that, and I think with just a few more kills in some rounds, they could have even beaten NIP with the level that Felix and Crystal were playing. So honestly, Berserk, even though they've been kicked out of the tournament and they've been kicked out of Group A, they've really shown that they're a quality team with quality players and are very capable. And I think they're very capable as a side. Really, they're providing a lot for the German scene.
Definitely. But the funny thing for me here is, or the sad thing for me here is that either SK Gaming or Fnatic are going to go out in this group, because virtus.pro, I don't see them go. Like, they're definitely going to make it through the group.
Solid.
They're just
far, far too solid.
They're so consistent. So, but SK Gaming and Fnatic are great teams, but one of them will not make it through.
Yep, that's true. And to be honest, these two groups really are the most competitive groups in the tournament.
Yes.
We're going to have some nice games tomorrow as well, but these are the most competitive groups. So we expect one of the teams from either Group A or Group B definitely will be in the final. I think maybe even two teams. I think both finalists might be from Group A and Group B.
Yeah, I think
you have three very strong teams.
I'm rooting for NIP because this is another concept when it comes to tournaments. Some players or teams are really, really good when it comes to group stages, but then they fall apart in the playoffs. And other teams, they struggle through the groups, then they turn it on when they get to the playoffs.
Yeah,
and,
exactly.
And in Quake as well, it's very similar. There's some players, you look at them and they're like the best player alive when it's in the groups.
Yeah.
When it comes to the playoffs, they can't compete.
They're not doing too well.
So it's a really interesting dynamic when you're at LANs. They're so different. The types of pressure, dealing with different environments, different atmospheres and stuff. It's really, really different. So NIP as well, they're on home turf. I think they will have a bit of a... You know, they were riding in the NIP bus. I mean, they are celebrities in Sweden.
Exactly.
So they've always have the crowd behind them.
Yeah, they've got the home crowd and they've got the advantage. And so this is telling us that perhaps most likely a Swedish side is going to win this tournament. I mean, that's kind of the pattern that we're seeing with LANs lately, is that the... home teams usually win. Which Swedish side? Probably Ninjas in Pyjamas.
Most likely, yeah. It's going to be interesting. But I guess we're going to take a quick break. Remember, in the break and any delays that you see, check out the Facebook platform. Go play some games on
it's
the...
Fun.
It is
a lot of fun.
Go get matched. If you haven't been ranked, rather, yet, then go get ranked. You have to play a few games, and you get ranked, you get placed into a league. You know, you can see it down there on the screen, Silver, Gold Master. So you can play with other people around your level, play for points and prizes and all that kind of cool jazz. So other than that, is there anything you want to add before we go to a break?
What I'd like to say is that if you do see me, I don't know about you as well, but if you do see me on Face It, say hi and be nice. You know, because I will be playing. And so if you do see me, be like, oh, hey, Vela, I like you, and you're a really nice guy. Not, oh, you're that caster who sucks. I'm only kidding. But yeah, I'd love to see you guys on Face It. I think it'd be a lot of fun playing. I've already played on there, and people have recognized me, which is really cool.
Yeah.
I think that's awesome. And everyone's been nice so far. People have been really nice. But don't be surprised if I don't play as well as I say I do. That's one thing. Casters, we're proper critical about players and whatnot, and then we do the same thing. Actually, we don't do the same thing. We do like 10 times worse. We completely flop the basic fundamentals. But that's one thing, you know, that we can do that, and we're allowed to do that.
What if someone said to you, wow, you're a better player than you are a caster? Is that a compliment or is that a diss, I wonder? Because that would be a smart one.
It wouldn't, because I know that I'm a bad player. So it would not be a compliment.
That's
said
the
that.
Thing. It's
it
like
just means I'm a horrible caster.
Yeah, it could be a pretty good one. That's a smart one.
That's
you
a good insult.
You guys can use that. If you see a Vela, you can use that one. It's a pretty smart one.
But if you're enjoying the cast so far, do send us some love hearts and do follow us on the Face It Twitter and follow DDK and DR Vela.
I'm actually going to be starting some live shows for CSGO, like analysis stuff in the future. I guess akin to the Day 9 Daily, it's like a similar kind of vibe going on as far as, you know, taking matches and just like going through them, analyzing everything. So if anyone's familiar with like the CT spotlights and the CSGO pro plays,
they're nice.
It's like a basically that, but like a live show.
Yeah.
So that can be found on my Twitch channel when I get started. Just waiting for graphics. It's going to start in the next couple of weeks. So you can follow me on Twitter and you'll be able to be notified through that medium when I start doing those shows. So if you're interested in that, check it out.
So thank you for tuning in. We have one more match today. So definitely tune back in. And we'll see you guys in a second.